and welcome to Behind the Science, where we ask challenging questions directly to the scientists who are trying to solve today's toughest problems. And I'm your host, Jennifer Fournier. In this episode of Behind the Science, we have a lingering question. What is the catch? We learned about a simple, fast way to prepare released N-glycan samples, but you must be giving something up for this time savings. Can something easy provide you quality results? There is no way you can have it all. Let me take you behind the science to help us answer the question of, what do we lose for a workflow that is so fast and simple? And I know just the scientist to ask. Hi, Darryl, how are you today?
Hey, Jen, I'm fine, how are you?
Great, we are looking to tackle tough questions about released N-glycan analysis, and I heard that you are one of the synthetic chemists that created RapiFluor-MS.
That's true, you've got me.
So what do we have to sacrifice for that simplicity? Kind of reminds me of the time that I went to get my car done. They put this expensive part in it, and a week later it broke down.
I'm not an expert with auto mechanics. Sorry to hear about your car, but I do know quite a bit about tagging of N-glycans, and really it's as simple as it seems.
So I also heard that you have a really cool lab. Do you think you can show me more?
You know, Jen, I'd love to, but kind of in the middle of something.
I do have a cookie.
To the lab!
Wow, this really is a cool lab, Darryl.
Thanks, Jen. This is really where it all happened.
So you promised me that this is easy to understand. Can you tell me more?
Yeah, probably the best way to do that is if we go to the whiteboard. The fact is, glycans cannot be seen by optical detectors or mass spec without some form of chemical modification. This modification, whether the reaction is slow or fast, is the key to sensitivity on any detector.
This is starting to make a lot of sense now, Darryl. So what I think you're telling me is that we need some type of reagent or label on these released N-glycans to be able to see them on a detector.
Yeah, that's exactly it, Jen. Once we made that decision, it came into the synthesis lab, and we spent quite a bit of time going through different novel prototypes. We even looked at procainamide, one of the MS-friendly forms that's been reported previously in the literature.
That sounds like science fiction.
Well, it's more like science fact. Here, let me show you where we ended up.
Great.
There are three components that are key to the success of the RapiFluor-MS reagent: a rapidly reacting succinylmethyl carbamate, a highly fluorescent quinoline chromophore, and an MS-active tertiary amine.
So this is the secret sauce.
Yeah, you could call it that. It's definitely the secret sauce that provides the sensitivity to allow us to get really good quality data.
To allow any glycoscientist to go where they've never gone before?
Well, they've been there before. This just allows them to get there a lot more easily and with a lot less sample.
So the question is, Darryl, what is the catch?
Really, the question is, Jen, where's my cookie?
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry about it. The only catch, because we can't eat cookies in the lab, is that this was really hard to make.
Well, thank you for your time, Darryl. Let's go get your cookie.
Thanks, Jen.
There really is no catch. But I guess it just goes to show that nothing is easy. For something to be just that good, many years of planning, research, learning, and understanding goes into something that is purposefully designed to meet a need. And on the rare occasion that it does happen, it's just like in a good sci-fi novel. Magic can happen. Check out the links below to learn more about the chemical attributes of the new label, and also a sneak peek on how those amazing results that were shown were achieved. Join us next time as we go behind the science to answer the next obvious question. How are these glycans analyzed? I feel a battle brewing. Cheers.